شكرا يا ربي شكرا هديت قلبي شكرا نورت دربي شكرا شكرا يا رب يا منزل القرآن يا خالق الإنسان يا ربي يا رحمن شكرا يا يا منزل القرآن يا خالق الإنسان يا ربي يا رحمن شكرا يا رب
شكرا يا ربي شكرا هديت قلبي شكرا نورت دربي شكرا شكرا يا رب
شكرا يا رب يا خالق الأكوان يا رب يا رحمن أكرمني بالغفران شكرا يا رب
شكرا يا رب
يا خالق الأكوان
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين سبحانك لا علم لنا إلا ما علمتنا إنك أنت العليم الحكيم اللهم علمنا ما ينفعنا وانفعنا بما علمتنا وزدنا علما وعملا متقبلا يا رب العالمين اللهم اغفر لنا ذنوبنا وإسرافنا في أمرنا وثبت أقدامنا وانصرنا على القوم الكافرين برحمتك يا أرحم الراحمين آمين. Beloved brothers and sisters, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. As for non-Muslim guests, may the guidance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala be with all of you. In the last episode, we spoke about the importance of gratitude in the life of the believer, beloved brothers and sisters. And we said that gratitude and patience constitute the two halves of our iman, our faith. They are like the two wings of the believer. Gratitude on the one hand for the bounties and the favors of Allah, patience in dealing with challenges, difficulties, hardships, calamities in our lives. And with these two, the life of the believer is one that is illuminated by the guidance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The person can enjoy the guidance and the bounties of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in his life, and he can be able to see the good and the blessings, see the positives of life. You can be able to enjoy the simple things of life with these two qualities of gratitude and patience. As the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said in the hadith, عَجَبًا لِأَمْرِ الْمُؤْمِنِ إِنَّ أَمْرَهُ كُلَّهُ لَهُ خَيْرٍ وَلَيْسَ ذَلِكَ لِأَحَدٍ إِلَّا لِلْمُؤْمِنِ. Amazing indeed is the affair of the believer. Everything for him is good, and that is for no one else except the believer, except the person who has iman. Why? Because in asabathu sarra'u shakara fa kana khayran lah, wa in asabathu dharra'u sabara fa kana khayran lah. When something good happens to him, something that brings happiness to him happens, then he is grateful to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He exhibits shukr, gratitude to Allah, and that is good for him, that is good for his iman. And when something bad happens to him, something which brings sorrow happens, then he exercises patience, and that is also good for him. So, as we said, beloved brothers and sisters, we must have patience, we must have gratitude, and we must have patience. And these two qualities go hand in hand. They necessitate one another. They are the two halves of iman. If one goes, the other will follow. We cannot be grateful if we are impatient, and vice versa. We cannot be truly patient if we are ungrateful to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So these two must go hand in hand. They necessitate one another. How? If we are enjoying a bounty of Allah, we have to be grateful and patient at the same time. It is clear that we have to be grateful for the bounty of Allah. We are enjoying it. We thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for it. But how do we exercise patience with that bounty at the same time? By refraining from using it in a way that is displeasing to Allah. And refraining from using it in that way is to exercise patience. It is to exercise patience in keeping away from that which is displeasing to Allah, as we will see in the types of patience, inshaAllah. So when we are enjoying a bounty, we have to be grateful, and at the same time, we have to be patient. And if we are facing a difficulty or a test or hardship, at the same time, we also have to be patient. And this is obvious. We be patient in the time of difficulty and hardship. But we have to also be grateful. How? By still, despite that challenge and that difficulty we are facing, by still recognizing the other favors of Allah and thanking Him for those, and by still continuing to fulfill the rights of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, despite the challenges or hardships we may be facing. So whatever the situation we are in, beloved brothers and sisters, we have to be exercising and exhibiting gratitude and patience. It doesn't mean that if we face difficulties or challenges, then there's no longer any reason to be grateful to Allah. We always have to be grateful to Allah, as we have mentioned in the previous episode. And now, we always have to exercise patience, beloved brothers and sisters. We all need this in every aspect of our lives, and almost every day of our lives, we are faced with situations where we have to exhibit patience. And patience illuminates the way for the person in life, and especially for the believer. As the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, was sabru diya. Sabr, patience, is illumination. It is light in front of us. Because when we learn to exercise patience, we see the way out of every difficulty and hardship in life. Allah opens up the doors of goodness for us. So we do not remain in a state of anxiety and frustration and frenzy and discontentment. No. If we are patient, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala shows us the way out of every difficulty we face in life. Hence, patience is illumination. Patience is one of the greatest virtues that we can exhibit, and that, you know, can be displayed in the character of the person. And it is manifested in so many other virtues that require some level of restraint. Because the meaning of sabr is from the word sabara, which means to restrain oneself, or to restrain something. So sabr and patience is really to remain steadfast on the straight path, and to refrain from doing that which is displeasing to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala when we face temptations, or we face challenges and hardships and tests of one sort and the other, or the other. It's to refrain from doing that which is displeasing to Allah, either by committing sin when we face temptations, or by becoming impatient and complaining and discontent and becoming discontented with the qadr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, His decree, when we face hardships and calamities. Patience, therefore, is to refrain from doing anything displeasing to Allah and remaining steadfast in the way that is pleasing to Allah by doing that which is good and keeping away from that which is displeasing to Allah. And as I said, it is related to so many other virtues, or it is manifested in so many other virtues that we exhibit, which require some level of restraint. So for example, to refrain from saying that which is unbecoming, patience is required for that. And to do this is called discretion. So discretion is part of patience, because we have to control our tongues to not say that which is unbecoming or that which is displeasing to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. To refrain from acting upon our anger. When we become angry with someone or for some reason, to refrain from acting and to restrain ourselves, this requires patience, and this is called forbearance. To refrain from taking revenge on someone when they do something to harm us or to hurt us in some way or the other, this requires patience, and it is called forgiveness. To refrain from fleeing in front of danger, for example, is called courage, and this also requires patience. To refrain from succumbing to one's greed and to maintain one's self-respect, this is exhibited in contentment, in self-control. All of this requires patience. So, at so many different levels in our lives, when we exhibit good morals that require some level of restraint, then patience is part of that, beloved brothers and sisters. This is not something that is separate from other aspects of life. In any situation in life in which we have to exercise some level of restraint, patience is required. Hence, it is such an important part of our iman. And without it, life would be very difficult. People would be very miserable on the face of the earth if they do not learn to exercise patience. Because Allah has told us that the nature of this life is that we will be tested. There must be tests. أَحَسِبَ النَّاسُ أَن يُتْرَكُوا أَن يَقُولُوا آمَنَّا وَهُمْ لَا يُفْتَنُونَ وَلَقَدْ فَتَنَّ الَّذِينَ مِنْ قَبْلِهِمْ فَلَيَعْلَمَنَّ اللَّهُ الَّذِينَ صَدَقُوا وَلَيَعْلَمَنَّ الْكَاذِبِينَ. Do people believe they will be left alone once they claim that they are believers and that they will not be tested, so that their iman will, they will not have to prove their iman? Verily, we tested those before. And Allah will make clear those who are true believers and those who are not. Tests are a part of life. We cannot run away from that. We are either in a state of ease or a state of difficulty. We are in a state of prosperity or adversity. We are in a state which brings some level of satisfaction and comfort and happiness to us, or it brings some level of sorrow, of sadness, of discomfort to us. We are either between this state or this state. And one requires gratitude, the other requires patience. And as I said, both of them at the same time still are intrinsically connected to the other. We cannot run away from being patient, beloved brothers and sisters. If we learn to exercise patience in life, things become much easier for us. We become more content with simple things in life. We learn to enjoy the bounties of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and appreciate what He has given to us, even though they may not seem to be as great as bounties enjoyed by other people. We do not deal with situations of hardship with anxiety. We do not become depressed. We are not in a state or frenzy all the time. We become people who are calm. We learn to recognize the will and the qadr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and to deal with it in a way that is pleasing to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And when we have this quality of patience, we learn to endure hardships and difficulties. The more we have patience, the more we can deal with challenges in life. These challenges do not cause us to buckle. They do not cause us to break down. They do not cause us to despair of life. So we do not have the tendencies of, for example, wanting to commit suicide, wanting to do something to harm ourselves because we feel that our challenges are insurmountable. No. When we have patience, we become like solid mountains, strong, firm mountains, standing against the challenges of the times and the days that come in front of us. And patience, beloved brothers and sisters, helps us to do mujahada. It helps us to push ourselves more and more, to achieve greater things, to rise to greater heights. You know, there is a saying in the Arabic language, the poet who says, لا تحسبن المجد تمرا أنت أكله لن تبلغ المجد حتى تلعق الصبر. He said, do not believe that glory and honor and achieving great heights is like a sweet date that you just eat. It is just something sweet that you will sit and enjoy. You will not be able to reach a level of glory and eminence and dignity until you taste sabira. And sabira is a bitter fruit. And incidentally, it is taken from the same root as sabr, which is patience. So patience is something bitter. It calls for effort. It calls for sacrifice. It calls for endurance. And so in the same way, that person, when he tastes that bitter fruit, he has to experience something unpleasant. Patience calls for that hardship and that sacrifice, or endurance of that hardship and sacrifice, so that we can be able to achieve our ambitions or aspirations and elevate ourselves in life. And likewise, Al-Imam al-Shafi'i rahimahullah, he told us, بِقَدْرِ الْكَدِّ تُكْتَسَبُ الْمَعَالِي وَمَنْ طَلَبَ الْعُلَى سَهِرَ اللَّيَالِي. Based on the heart and the efforts that you make, the hard work that you put in, that's the heights that you will be able to reach. And whoever wants to reach the lofty heights, he stays up late at night. So beloved brothers and sisters, patience helps us to push ourselves more, to achieve greater things. And if we do not have that patience, we will not have the determination, we will not have the resolve to push ourselves. We will have lofty dreams and goals, but without the necessary effort, it will just be wishful thinking. So, beloved brothers and sisters, as believers, we have to exhibit patience in our lives at all times. If it is the mother at home who has to cook and perhaps clean, and perhaps in this pandemic, for example, take care of the children and follow their schoolwork and perhaps do their follow up their schoolwork online with them. This requires a lot of patience. If it is the father who has to assist, whether it's in the home or he has to go out to seek his livelihood and, you know, face the challenges of doing work outside, then that requires patience. If it is the employer or the employee in these times, in this pandemic, with all of the challenges and the economic crisis that is looming, all of this requires patience. Everybody at every level in society and even in their personal lives, we require patience every single day. What are the types of patience, beloved brothers and sisters? The scholars explain that there are three types of patience. The first is as-sabr ala ta'at, that is patience in doing good deeds. Secondly, patience in avoiding evil. And thirdly, patience in facing calamities and trials. So with respect to our deen, we have obligations which we have to fulfill. And we have prohibitions which we have to keep away from. Patience is required in both of these. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has commanded us to, for example, pray our five daily salah. This requires patience. We have to push ourselves to stand, to perform the salah, to go through the effort that is necessary to do it. And there are many who will say, well, that's too difficult for me. I can't manage with it. But that attitude is a result of the lack of patience. There is no patience being exhibited, so that we see no resolve in trying to fulfill the commands of Allah that we have to perform. The month of Ramadan is a time of fasting. It requires patience. The Prophet ﷺ said that this month is the month of patience. And again, we will see many people who say, well, fasting is too difficult for me. I can't endure hunger and thirst for such a long time. So they fail to fast. They fail to fulfill this obligation that they have to. Again, this requires patience. But we need to understand that to gain the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and to gain His pleasure, effort is required. So patience must be exhibited. We cannot hope to achieve success in this world without making that effort, without exhibiting that patience to obey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is a necessary aspect of patience or type of patience that must be there in our lives. Patience in fulfilling the commands of Allah and in doing good deeds. So this is two levels. Patience in fulfilling the commands of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, this is not a matter in which we have choice. We have to perform our five daily salah. We have to fast in the month of Ramadan. We have to, if we can afford to, we have to perform the Hajj. And all of these have some level of hardship that requires patience in order to fulfill them. And then there is the other level of patience in doing extra good deeds to push ourselves. And especially in this last part of the month of Ramadan, beloved brothers and sisters, that we are about to enter the last, or we have now entered into the last third of the month of Ramadan. And this is the time when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam would push himself the most. And the hadith tells us that when the last third of the month of Ramadan would come, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam would stay up all night. Ahya al-layl wa ayqadha ahla, and he would wake his family to also pray at night. Wa shadda al-mi'zar, and he would tighten his waistband, push himself more, to dedicate himself more to the worship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, even though he pushed himself so much already in the worship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala under normal circumstances. And in the month of Ramadan, he would keep pushing himself more. In the last third, he pushed himself the most, because this is coming down to the end of the race, so to speak. And this is when we make our greatest push. And this is the time when we strive to seek the greatest night in the year, Laylatul Qadr, the night of decree, which, as the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, is better than 1,000 months. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam would push himself. And he encouraged us to push ourselves in these last 10 nights. And he said that whoever has been deprived of the goodness of this night has been truly deprived. If one night is better than 1,000 months, that is more than 83 years of worship just in one night. More than 83 years of worship. Allah has placed barakah, His blessings and His goodness in this night. It deserves all the effort we can make to seek it and the patience we can exhibit in worshipping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in this period of time to seek it. To push ourselves for 10 days to do more good in the hope of achieving that one night that is greater than 83 years of more worship, that is not much of a price to ask. But for us to say, well, a whole 10 days I have to push myself, that is too much. It shows a lack of resolve. And we need to be strong, beloved brothers and sisters. This is part of our iman. We need to exhibit that patience. So, to do extra good deeds, to sit for a longer period of time and recite more Quran. Now, if we would normally have the capacity or the patience to sit for 10 minutes to recite, let's sit for half an hour and recite more Quran. If we would normally do a certain amount of dhikr, let's push ourselves to do more dhikr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If we would pray 4 raka'at of salah in a night, let's push ourselves to pray a little bit more. Or if we would pray, and recite half a page in our salah, in our each raka'ah, let us push ourselves to recite more. So we keep increasing, we keep pushing ourselves, we're exhibiting this patience in the worship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the more we exhibit this patience and the more we make this effort, the greater the reward, obviously, with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And we see the beautiful examples of the prophets that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told us about in the Holy Quran. Ibrahim alayhi salam, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commanded him in his dream to make the ultimate sacrifice that called for a greatest level of patience. This was an act of obedience to Allah. We are speaking about patience in obeying Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and in fulfilling our obligations to Him and doing good deeds. He was commanded to sacrifice his son, the person who was most beloved to him, who he had waited and yearned for so many years until he became an old man, and then he was blessed with a child. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commanded him to sacrifice in the ultimate test. But he passed that test along with his son Ismail alayhi salam with flying colors. And listen, you can only imagine the amount of patience that had to be exhibited, the amount of faith that had to be exhibited in this type of a test and this type of a sacrifice that was required of Ibrahim alayhi salam and his son. We are asked to stand up and pray 5 times a day, we find difficulty with that. We are asked to fast for a few hours of the day, we find difficulties with that. What about this magnitude and this level of test? But when they submitted completely, Ismail alayhi salam, he said to his father, Ya abatif'al ma tu'mar, satajiduni insha'allahu minas sabirin. Oh my father, do as you are commanded. You will find me, insha'Allah, of those who are patient. It's patience from the father, patience from the son in obeying the command of Allah. And when they submitted, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala relieved them of that obligation or that responsibility. And he ransomed Ismail alayhi salam with a great ram. As he tells us in the Holy Quran, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, in fulfilling the obligation of da'wah, in conveying the message of Islam, he went through so many difficulties and hardships. He had to exhibit patience at all levels. People called him all sorts of names, hurtful nicknames, madman, a soothsayer, and whatever else they called him, sahir. They physically harmed him. They threw thorns in his pathway. They tried their best to dissuade him physically. Abu Jahl, so many repeatedly, different times, he physically trying to harm the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Persecution. They boycotted and persecuted them for so many years. But yet the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam persevered. He went to Ta'if and he was stoned until his sandals were caked with blood. But yet he persevered. Patience in fulfilling the commands of Allah. And in addition to that, he used to stand for so many hours at night and pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, obeying Allah until his feet would become swollen. As we mentioned before, and Aisha radiallahu anha asked him, why is it that you do this, Ya Rasulullah, when all of your previous sins have been forgiven? And he said, أَفَلَا أَكُونُ عَبْدًا شَكُورًا, shall I not be a grateful slave? But standing here is gratitude to Allah, but it requires patience. As we said before, both, each one necessitates the other. To stand for hours praying in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala requires patience. So beloved brothers and sisters, in this month of Ramadan, and in this last third of the month of Ramadan, let us exhibit beautiful patience. Let us strive to push ourselves to do more and more good deeds. And let us not become bored and too tired with acts of obedience to Allah, because the returns at this time are without limit. They are numerous. And only Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows the blessings that are given and that are distributed in these most blessed times. So let us strive to seize the opportunity and capitalize as much as we can, and exhibit beautiful patience by pushing ourselves to do more than we have been doing in the first part of the month of Ramadan. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala allow us to witness Laylatul Qadr and gain all of its blessings. And may He grant us the beautiful blessings and rewards of the whole month of Ramadan as well. Ameen. The second part of patience, or type of patience, is patience in the face of temptations and patience in keeping away from sins. So just as we have patience in fulfilling the duties of Allah, our duties to Allah, fulfilling our obligations and doing good deeds, then there is patience in keeping away from evil. Because the shaitan, his job is to whisper and to tempt. And we have our base desires. So we are faced with so many situations on a daily basis in which, you know, we are tempted to fulfill our base desires in one way or another. But this fulfillment of these desires constitutes disobedience to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And it will bring the displeasure of Allah. And so patience is required to control ourselves, to refrain from fulfilling our desires in a way that is prohibited, in a way that is haram, in a way that is displeasing to Allah. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in His infinite mercy, He has given us the halal alternatives, the lawful means through which we can fulfill our desires. So if those lawful means are available to us, then alhamdulillah, we have no excuse. If they are unavailable to us, then more patience is required in these circumstances. And we beg Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make our affairs easy for us until those means become available, or they become easy for us, inshaAllah. So we must continue striving to exhibit and exercise patience in keeping away from that which is displeasing to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the third type of patience is the patience in the face of calamities. And this obviously is one of the first aspect of patience that comes to our minds when we speak about hardships, calamities, difficulties. To exercise patience, we always think about tests, we think about difficulties. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has told us, as I mentioned in the verse before, that we cannot claim to be believers and we will not be tested. Tests are a part of life. وَلَنَبْلُوَنَّكُمْ حَتَّى نَعْلَمَ الْمُجَاهِدِينَ مِنْكُمْ وَالصَّابِرِينَ وَنَبْلُوَ أَخْبَارَكُمْ. And definitely we will test you until we establish those who make effort, those who strive, and those who are patient, and we will test your affairs. Allah has promised He will test us. And He has told us, أَمْ حَسِبْتُمْ أَن تَدْخُلُوا الْجَنَّةِ وَلَمَّا يَعْلَمِ اللَّهُ الَّذِينَ جَاهَدُوا مِنْكُمْ وَيَعْلَمَ الصَّابِرِينَ. Do you believe that you will enter Jannah and Allah has not yet established those of you who strive in His path and those who are patient? Patience is a part of life. وَلَنَبْلُوَنَّكُمْ بِشَيْءٍ مِّنَ الْخَوْفِ وَالْجُوعِ وَنَقْصٍ مِّنَ الْأَمْوَالِ وَالْأَنفُسِ وَالثَّمَرَاتِ وَبَشِّرِ الصَّابِرِينَ. And definitely we will test you with something of fear and hunger, a loss of wealth, a loss of lives and crops and fruits. Tests will come in all these different ways. Allah has said we will definitely test you. It will either come in the form of fear, come in the form of hunger, come in the form of loss, whether it's loss of someone passing away in the family, death of a close relative, or loss of wealth in one way or another, or loss of crops, business, some way or the other. There will be tests. But then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَبَشِّرِ الصَّابِرِينَ. But give glad tidings to the patient ones. الَّذِينَ إِذَا أَصَابَتْهُمْ مُصِيبَةٌ قَالُوا إِنَّا لِلَّهِ وَإِنَّا إِلَيْهِ رَاجِعُونَ. Those who, when they are afflicted with a calamity, they say, verily, to Allah we belong and to Him we shall return. We are from Allah, and whatever we have is from Allah. And we will return to Allah to give an account for how we live in this life. So whatever comes from Allah, it is something that we have to accept as the qadr, the decision of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and therefore we deal with it with patience. This is the essence of what Allah is telling us in these verses. Life will be filled with tests, and tests require patience. But does it mean, if Allah tests us, does it mean that Allah doesn't love us? Does it mean that Allah just wants hardship for us? Deliberately wants to just make us miserable in life? No. Rather, tests are a sign of the love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It may seem strange, but we call this blessing in disguise. They are a sign of the love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for His servant, but in return, the servant is expected to deal with it in the proper way. Remember the hadith at the beginning? إِنَّ أَمْرَهُ كُلَّهُ لَهُ خَيْرٌ وَلَيْسَ ذَٰلِكَ لِأَحَدٍ إِلَّا لِلْمُؤْمِنِ. Everything for the believer is good, and that is for no one else except the believer. If the person doesn't have iman, then situations will not all be good for that person, because He will not deal with them in a way that is pleasing to Allah. And his iman will not be there to gain the acceptance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But if the person has iman, he has faith and belief in Allah, and then he deals with these issues, these challenges and problems with patience, that is all good for him. And as I said, this is a sign of the love of Allah. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam said, "Inna idhamal جَزَاءَ مَعَ عِظَمِ الْبَلَىٰ وَإِنَّ اللَّهَ تَعَالَىٰ إِذَا أَحَبَّ قَوْمًا ابْتَلَاهُمْ فَمَنْ رَضِيَ فَلَهُ الرِّضَىٰ وَمَنْ سَخِطَ فَلَهُ السَّخَطَ. Verily, the great rewards come according to the magnitude of the tests. The greatness of the reward that the person will receive will be based on the greatness of the test that the person faces. So the harder the test, and the more we have to endure, the greater the reward with Allah. And when Allah loves His servant, وَإِنَّ اللَّهَ تَعَالَى إِذَا أَحَبَّ عَبْدًا إِبْتَلَاهُ. If Allah loves His servant, then He gives him tests. We will face more tests if we are closer to Allah. فَمَنْ رَضِيَ فَلَهُ الرِّضَى. So whoever is pleased with the test of Allah, then he will receive the pleasure of Allah. Whoever deals with that test in a way that is pleasing with Allah, Allah will be pleased with him. But whoever becomes displeased, becomes disgruntled, becomes dissatisfied, and complains, then he will receive the displeasure of Allah. So, for that test to be a blessing in disguise, it requires the proper and the suitable response from us, beloved brothers and sisters. And that is to be patient and still grateful to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Those who receive the greatest tests are those who are closest to Allah. So tests are not a sign that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has forsaken the person or He dislikes the person. No. They are an opportunity to gain greater blessings of Allah. They are an opportunity to expiate for the sins that we have committed and to gain Allah's mercy, His forgiveness, His rewards. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, يُبْتَلَى الْمَرْءُ عَلَى قَدْرِ دِينِهِ فَإِنْ وُجِدَ فِي دِينِهِ صَلَابَةٌ زِيلَ فِي بَلَائِهِ. A man is tested, or a person is tested, according to the strength of his deen. How strong a believer he is. How committed he is to the practice of his deen. If there is strength in his deen, in his faith, and in his religion, then his test will be increased. And that is why those who received the greatest tests were those who were closest to Allah, the prophets. As the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam told us, أشد الناس بلاء الأنبياء والصالحون ثم الأمثل فالأمثل. Those who received the greatest tests are the prophets, and then the pious people, and then as good as they are, that is how the strength or the magnitude of the test that they will receive. So those who received the greatest tests were the prophets. As we saw with Ibrahim alayhi salam, being given that ultimate test of being asked to sacrifice his son. And the tests of so many other prophets, as we have seen, like Ayyub alayhi salam. Prophet Ayyub, who was tested for such a long period of time, and who was tested with his wealth, that he lost all of his wealth, he lost all of his children, he lost his health for many years, but he continued to be patient. And as a result of that patience, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala returned all of his favors to him. And he blessed him again with his wealth, with wealth and with children and with good health and so on. And likewise, we see with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, so many tests that he faced in life. He lost all of his male children as well, when they're in their childhood, in their early childhood, when they were small. He faced hunger for days on end. There would be no fire lit in his home because they had nothing to eat. And he would come home. These are examples that we look at, beloved brothers and sisters, to see how far we are, how blessed we are, how much we are enjoying the bounties of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that we still have so much in our homes. But yet sometimes we may complain that we don't have. That the Prophet ﷺ would come home, he would return home from the masjid, and he would ask his wife, is there anything to eat in the morning? This is in the morning. And his wife would say, no, we don't have anything to eat. And then he would say, فَإِنِّي صَائِمٌ. Well, then I am fasting. If you don't have anything to eat, then I am fasting. He would make his intention. And of course, this is a nafl, voluntary fast, and it is permissible to make the intention even after sunrise, so long as the person has not eaten from before Fajr. So the Prophet ﷺ would make this intention to show the contentment and the level of patience that he would exercise. And when he became ill, his illness was much greater than the normal pain, the normal fever that a normal person would face. As one of his companions, when he was suffering from his illness and fever once, one of his companions entered, and when he felt his temperature, he said, Ya Rasulallah, innaka tu'aku wa'akan shadida. Ya Rasulallah, you have very, very high fever. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, yes, inni u'aku kama yu'aku rajulani minkum. I get fever, the intensity of my fever is like that of two people from among you. Double the pain, double the fever and the intensity of a normal person. This is what the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam would face. Was this because Allah didn't love him? Was this because Allah wanted hardship for him? No. But because of the strength of his iman. And that test is a blessing in disguise, to raise him to higher and higher ranks in the sight of Allah. So let us look at ourselves, beloved brothers and sisters, and let us see that when we are faced with tests, these are not excuses for us to cry and grumble and complain and exhibit impatience, as Allah mentioned, about the human being who doesn't have iman. إِذَا مَسَّهُ الشَّرُّ جَزُوعًا. When hardship or difficulty comes to him, he becomes impatient. Let us not exhibit that type of attitude, beloved brothers and sisters. Our iman calls for us to be patient. And when we do so, the rewards of Allah are tremendous. So let us look at what has been promised. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala loves those who are patient. إِنَّ اللَّهَ يُحِبُّ الصَّابِرِينَ وَاللَّهُ يُحِبُّ الصَّابِرِينَ. Allah loves the patient ones. And if we have the love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, what else do we require in order to be successful, beloved brothers and sisters? إِنَّ اللَّهَ مَعَ الصَّابِرِينَ. Allah is with those who are patient. So the help and the support of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is with those who are patient. So when we go through hard times and we face challenges, with patience and dealing with these challenges in the way that is pleasing to Allah, the help of Allah will come. وَعْلَمْ أَنَّ النَّصْرَ مَعَ الصَّبْرِ وَأَنَّ الْفَرَجَ مَعَ الْكَرْبِ وَأَنَّ مَعَ الْعُسْرِ يُسْرًا. Know that victory comes with patience, and ease comes after difficulty. Solutions to problems come after the problems we face, or when we face the problems with patience. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has promised us ease, but we have to deal with the challenges in the way that is pleasing to Allah, so that we will receive these blessings. Those who are truly patient, they will be rewarded according to the best deeds that they have done. And their reward will be without limit, as Allah says, إِنَّمَا يُوَفَّى الصَّابِرُونَ أَجْرَهُمْ بِغَيْرِ حِسَابٍ. Verily, the patient ones are given their reward without limit. And he said, وَلَنَجْزِيَنَّ الَّذِينَ صَبَرُوا أَجْرَهُمْ بِأَحْسَنِ مَا كَانُوا يَعْمَلُونَ. And verily, we will bless those who are patient with the rewards of the best actions that they used to do. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will look at the best actions that we perform and He will reward us according to those actions if we are patient, beloved brothers and sisters. And Allah has promised, for those who are patient, they will receive His blessings. They receive His mercy, they receive His guidance. In essence, we can see that all of the good and all of the ingredients for the success of the person in this world and in the hereafter are attached to being patient. وَبَشِّرِ الصَّابِرِينَ And give glad tidings to those who are patient. الَّذِينَ إِذَا أَصَابَتْهُمْ مُصِيبَةٌ قَالُوا إِنَّا لِلَّهِ وَإِنَّا إِلَيْهِ رَاجِعُونَ Those who, when they are afflicted with some calamity, they say, Verily we are from Allah and to Him we shall return. What is the reward? أُولَٰئِكَ عَلَيْهِمْ صَلَوَاتٌ مِّن رَبِّهِمْ وَرَحْمَةٌ وَأُولَٰئِكَ هُمُ الْمُهْتَدُونَ Upon those people are the blessings of their Lord. Their Lord sends and showers His blessings upon them. وَرَحْمَةٌ And His mercy. وَأُولَٰئِكَ هُمُ الْمُهْتَدُونَ And those are the ones who are truly guided. So, patience is illumination. It brings the guidance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in this world. It brings the mercy and the blessings of Allah in this world and the mercy and the blessings of Allah in the hereafter so that ultimately the person gains the forgiveness of Allah and expiation for the sins that he has committed. As the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, مَا يُصِيبُ الْمُسْلِمْ مِنْ نَصَبٍ وَلَا وَصَبٍ There is no fatigue, no illness that afflicts the believer. وَلَا هَمٍّ وَلَا حَزَنٍ No worry, you know, no problem that comes that causes him worry and sleeplessness. وَلَا حَزَنٍ Or something, nothing that brings sorrow to him, some calamity that brings sorrow to him, brings sadness to him. وَلَا أَذَنٍ وَلَا غَمٍ Or something that brings hurt or harm to him in some way or the other. Or it causes some anxiety to him. حَتَّى الشَّوْكَةُ يُشَاكُهَا Even a thorn that pricks his foot. And he deals with this with patience. Because this is what a believer does. إِلَّا كَفَّرَ اللَّهُ بِهَا مِنْ خَطَايَهَا Except that these hardships will become a source of expiation or a cause for expiation of his sins. Allah will keep wiping out his sins through these hardships that he faces. And the merit of the hardship is not in the hardship itself, beloved brothers and sisters, but it is in our response to the hardship, as we are saying. Because there are many who face hardships, but they don't respond in a suitable way. Are they going to be blessed for that? No. Allah says, فَصَبْرٌ جَمِيلٌ Ya'qub alayhi salam, he said, فَصَبْرٌ جَمِيلٌ When he faced his tests of being deprived of his son Yusuf alayhi salam, and his sadness led to the point of him becoming blind. He said, فَصَبْرٌ جَمِيلٌ I am exhibiting beautiful patience. And that beautiful patience means I will not grumble and complain and show dissatisfaction with the decision of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Even though it is okay to be sad, it is okay even to cry, but not to scream and wail in the way that some people overreact sometimes. It is okay to feel sad. I will not show dissatisfaction with the qadr of Allah. Allah will choose for me that which He knows I have the ability to bear. لا يكلف الله نفسا إلا وسعها Allah will not put on any soul a burden more than it can bear. So whatever situation we face, this is for the believer, this is inshallah a blessing in disguise. It is a sign of the love of Allah. We know that Allah will not put a burden on us more than we can bear. And inshallah, it will be a source for all of this goodness and all of these blessings of Allah. The love of Allah, the help of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the limitless rewards, expiation for the sins of the person, and ultimately the Jannah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah tells us in the Holy Quran, again, أم حسبتم أن تدخلوا الجنة ولما يعلم الله الذين جاهدوا منكم ويعلم الصابرين. Do you believe that you will just enter Jannah? And it has not yet been established. Those of you who will strive and make effort and those who will be patient. So patience is one of the most critical ingredients to achieve the Jannah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And in different aspects of life, in different tests, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has told us that the person will receive Jannah if he remains patient. Patient, Allah tells us in the Hadith Qudsi, إِذَا ابْتَلَيْتُ عَبْدِي بِحَبِيبَتَيْهِ فَصَبَرْ عَوَضْتُهُ مِنْهُمَ الْجَنَّةِ. If I test my servant with his two beloved, meaning his two eyes, and he remains patient, I will compensate him with Jannah. In another Hadith Qudsi, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, مَا لِعَبْدِ الْمُؤْمِنِ عندي جزاء إذا قبضت صفيه من أهل الدنيا ثم احتسبه إلا الجنة. My believing servant will have no other reward if I take away his beloved of this dunya. Someone who is beloved to him, his child, or someone who is close to him, who is beloved to him of his dunya, and he remains patient and he hopes for the reward of Allah, there is no other reward for him except Jannah. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us about those believers who exhibit patience in doing good deeds and fulfilling their duties of salah and giving charity and so on, and following up bad deeds with good ones, that they will be admitted into Jannah along with the righteous people from their parents and their spouses and their children, and the angels will give them glad tidings upon entry into Jannah and will say, Salamun alaykum bima sabartum. Peace be with you because of the patience that you exhibited. This is the reward that you have. فَنِعْمَ عُقْبَ الدَّارِ. What a beautiful consequence you have in this beautiful abode of Jannah because of your patience. Beloved brothers and sisters, we are required to exhibit patience in all of these different aspects of our lives as part of our iman. And in order to do so, we need to recognize, first of all, that whatever comes to us, it was never going to miss us. Whatever happens to us, it was written to happen. وَاعْلَمْ أَنَّمَا أَخْطَأَكَ لَمْ يَكُنْ لِيُصِيبَكَ وَمَا أَصَابَكَ لَمْ يَكُنْ لِيُخْطِئَكَ. Know that whatever happens to you was never going to pass you by. And whatever passed you by was never going to come to you. So whatever situation we face, whether it's something that unpleasant that happened to us, which we were hoping not to happen, or whether we were hoping to achieve something and it didn't happen, it was never going to be any different. Because it is written to happen exactly like that. This is what we call the qadr of Allah, the decision of Allah. And so we must first of all recognize that everything that happens, it happens only by the permission and the will of Allah, and we are required to accept that qadr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. As the ayah tells us, الَّذِينَ إِذَا أَصَابَتْهُمْ مُصِيبَةٌ قَالُوا إِنَّا لِلَّهِ وَإِنَّا إِلَيْهِ رَاجِعُونَ. Those who, when they are faced with any calamity or any difficulty, they say, from Allah we come and to Him we shall return. They say, قَدَّرَ اللَّهُ مَا شَاءَ فَعَلْ. Allah decrees and He does what He wills. They accept and they submit to the qadr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the time, the most crucial time to exhibit patience is at the first impact, the first shock of the calamity. As the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, إِنَّمَا الصَّبْرُ عِنَّ الصَّدْمَةِ الْأُولَى. Verily, the most important time of patience, most critical time to exercise patience is at the first shock. You know, it negates patience and conflicts with patience if when we face the calamity we scream and we carry on in a way that is unbecoming and that shows total dissatisfaction with the decision of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And after a good while of behaving in this way, then we say, okay, I will now be patient. No. Patience has to be exhibited when we first face the shock of the calamity. And in order to do so, or to help us to do so, we must have ihtisab. We must say to ourselves that I am going to exhibit and exercise patience seeking the reward of Allah. I will do it sincerely. If I am patient, I will receive the reward of Allah. وَلِرَبِّكَ فَاصْبِرْ. And for your Lord, be patient. For the pleasure of your Lord, be patient. So when you face that calamity, when we face the calamity, let us look at it and say, you know what? Allah has decided this for me. I will be patient, seeking the reward of Allah. And inshallah, we will not be deprived of that reward. And as we have seen, the rewards are tremendous. And to help us to be patient, let us make dua. وَاصْبِرْ وَمَا صَبْرُكَ إِلَّا بِاللَّهِ. Be patient, and you cannot exercise patience except with the help of Allah. اِسْتَعِينُوا بِالصَّبْرِ وَالصَّلَاةِ. Seek help with patience and prayer. Ask Allah. Call upon Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for help, as the prophets did. Allah tells us about so many instances in the Holy Quran where they turned to Allah and they asked Him in their times of need. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala helped them. Ayyub alayhi salam, for example, when he said, أَنِّي مَسَّنِيَ الضُّرُّ وَأَنْتَ أَرْحَمُ الرَّاحِمِينَ. My Lord, harm has come to me and you are the most merciful. فَاسْتَجَبْنَا لَهُ فَكَشَّفْنَا مَا بِهِ مِنْ ضُرُّ. And we answered his dua and we alleviated the harm that he was afflicted with. So let us turn to Allah. Let us beg Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, raise our hands to Him and ask Him for ease out of difficulties we face. But let us exhibit patience, beloved brothers and sisters. And patience will illuminate our path in this world, so that inshallah we have a beautiful existence. So that inshallah we live satisfying lives. We live with happiness and with contentment on the face of the earth, and we receive the beautiful rewards that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has placed for those who exercise patience and gratitude. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive us for our shortcomings, and may He grant us His mercy and His Jannah in the Akhirah, and save us from the punishment of the hellfire. Ameen. Aqulu qawli hadha wa astaghfirullah li wa lakum. Wassalamu alaykum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.